Penguin Random House Audio presents They Said It Couldn't Be Done, The 69 Mets, New York City, and the Most Astounding Season in Baseball History, by Wayne Coffey, read for you by Gary Cohen. Prologue. 41 is a notable number in the history of Flushing, Queens, the biggest and easternmost borough of New York City. It's not so much because the neighborhood sits hard by the 41st latitude, or because the number was once worn by men named Gordon Richardson and Jim Bethke, both of whom pitched briefly for the local baseball team, the New York Mets, in the mid-1960s. It's more because of the person to wear it after them, a rookie from Fresno, California, named George Thomas Seaver. He arrived in New York in 1967, and unlike Richardson and Bethke, was a starting pitcher. He wore number 41 with such distinction that no Met will ever put it on again. Tom Seaver and his contemporaries played their ball games at Shea Stadium, where the Mets took up residence in 1964 and stayed until 2008. Built on top of an ash heap, Shea opened just ahead of the 1964 World's Fair, not far from the former site of Ned's Diner on Roosevelt Avenue. In its fifth year of existence, two men walked on the moon. 400,000 people descended on a farm in New York's Catskill Mountains for the biggest and muddiest musical event in history, and Shea Stadium became the epicenter of the baseball world. The last of these developments was the most unforeseen. Shea Stadium was a bowl-shaped edifice, long on symmetry, short on character. Its most notable architectural feature, the blue and orange tiles that were speckled around its perimeter like rectangular graffiti. It was located a long toss from a bay and creek that bore the name Flushing, an anglicized derivation of the Dutch town Vlissingen given to the area by its first European settlers. In its earliest days, Flushing was the horticultural hub of New York City, a locale with rich creekside earth that spawned a wide assortment of trees and shrubs, along with the first commercial nursery in the United States. Started by a father and son, Robert and William Prince, the nursery opened for business almost 40 years before the signing of the Declaration of Independence. In Shea Stadium's formative years, it was known for neither fertile soil nor winning baseball. A four-sided clock tower with the words Serval Zippers rose in plain view over the left center field fence. For decades, the Serval Zipper Company helped people keep their pants and dresses on, but paid scant attention to its clock, which was stuck at 10:59 for years and showed no more signs of getting unstuck than the Mets showed of ever leaving last place. The Mets began life as an expansion team in 1962, joining the National League along with the Houston Colt 45s, renamed the Astros late in 1964, to coincide with their move into baseball's first indoor ballpark, the Astrodome. Their principal owner was Joan Whitney Payson, a scion of one of the nation's wealthiest families, a woman whose ancestry traced back to the Mayflower. A patron of the arts and noted philanthropist, Payson also had a deep passion for horse racing and baseball, owning a number of thoroughbreds and a minority share in the New York Giants. When the Giants and Brooklyn Dodgers decamped for California after the 1957 season, Payson was among the appalled masses who couldn't imagine life in New York without a National League ball club. So when the league announced it was adding two franchises, Payson bought one. She thus became the first woman to purchase a club in big league history. Payson hired former Yankees general manager George Weiss to be the Mets' first president. Weiss, in turn, hired 71-year-old Casey Stengel, who had led the Yankees to 7 World Series titles and 3 American League pennants in 12 years, to be their manager. The two men had unassailable baseball credentials, but their winning pedigree did not carry over to their new enterprise. The 1962 Mets went 40 and 120, losing more games than any ball club in the 20th century and finishing 60 and a half games out of first place. This is not easy to do. It requires staggeringly poor results over the full 6-month season, and that is precisely what the Mets achieved, with losing streaks of 9 games to start the season, 13 games, and 17 games, along with another patch in which they lost 16 of 17. The 62 Mets made 3 errors in their first game, 3 in their last game, and 204 more errors in between. Crisp baseball was in such short supply that one player remembered a road trip in which Stenkel announced the day's itinerary. There will be 2 buses to the park from the hotel. The 2 o'clock bus is for those who need a little extra work, and then there will be an empty bus leaving at 5 o'clock. The Mets' last rally of their debut season, 2 on and nobody out against the Cubs in the top of the 8th inning of game 160 at Wrigley Field, ended when catcher Joe Pignatano, a former Dodger and future Mets coach, came on for Clarence Choo Choo Coleman and hit into a triple play. It would be Pignatano's final big league at bat, clearing his schedule to report to his off-season job in the toy department at Abraham & Strauss, a Brooklyn department store. The Mets played their first 2 seasons in the Polo Grounds, the former home of Payson's beloved New York Giants in Upper Manhattan, just across the Harlem River from Yankee Stadium, before relocating to Shea. The move changed little beyond their mailing address. The Mets continued to lead all of baseball in futility, averaging 108 losses per season in their first half dozen years, an avalanche of defeats that did nothing to diminish the enthusiasm of their ever-faithful fans, who kept coming through the turnstiles and kept embracing the players' earnest, if unavailing, efforts to win an occasional game. Steve Apthecker was one of those fans, a 14-year-old from the Canarsie section of Brooklyn when the Mets were born, who grew up to be a lawyer and eventually moved his practice, not by accident, to a few miles from the New York Mets spring training headquarters in Port St. Lucie, Florida. To Apthecker, the indefatigable spirit of Mets fans had everything to do with the heartache that came from when their National League forebears, the Brooklyn Dodgers, bolted for the West Coast after the 1957 season. You can't overestimate the horror of losing the Dodgers and of wandering in the wilderness for 4 years, Apthecker said. The Mets were our salvation. Indeed, the Dodgers had been as much a part of their Flatbush neighborhood as the concrete sidewalks on Bedford Avenue. Dr. Joseph Vitteritti, a professor of public policy at New York's Hunter College, used to bike on those sidewalks to go to games. He and most all of the neighborhood kids would play stickball, stoop ball, box ball, and punch ball, every variation of baseball that their urban environment could accommodate. Baseball was their sport, and playing in Ebbets Field one day was their dream. After Dodgers games, the kids would wait on the Sullivan Street side of Ebbets, where the players would exit the park, relishing the proximity of their ball-playing heroes. The players made good money, certainly, but not so much that they lived in gated suburban mansions or Manhattan penthouses. These weren't distant millionaire idols. They were participants in daily borough life, mostly living and raising their families in the neighborhood. Vitteritti, the son of a shipfitter at the Brooklyn Navy Yard, liked that. He liked that Gil Hodges' brother-in-law owned Jack's Barbershop on Washington Avenue, and that there was a photo in the front window of Hodges stretching forward from first base to scoop up a throw. Sometimes the man himself would show up and would always honor every autograph request. The day Vitteritti got his Gil Hodges autograph, he tore a piece of loose-leaf paper from his school binder and was awed by the size of Hodges' forearms as he signed his name. One of Vitteritti's favorite parts of Ebbets Field was the movie theater-style marquee atop the ballpark between center field and right field. Beneath the words, "Next Game," were white letters on a black background displaying the name of the upcoming opponent, date, and game time. The marquee always gave young Joe Vitteritti something to look forward to. On the night of September 24, 1957, he and a friend biked over to Ebbets one last time. After 67 years in Brooklyn, the Dodgers were closing up shop. The Dodgers beat the Pirates 2-0 behind Danny McDevitt. A shortstop named Don Zimmer had the last hit at Ebbets Field. Gil Hodges had an RBI single, but also made the last Dodger out, striking out in the bottom of the 8th. "We looked up at the next game sign, and it was blank," Vitteritti said. "That's when it hit us. They were really leaving. There would be no next game. It was devastating. It was like losing a member of your family. Steve Apthecker can barely say the word Dodgers without gagging even now, more than six decades later. He can tell you about his first visit to Ebbets Field sitting behind.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.